Thank you very much, Professor Sobhanlal Datta Gupta. I believe it's a great pleasure and a privilege for me to be invited over here this afternoon to speak on Wittgenstein. This is his 125th birth anniversary, and apparently the program started in September, so come September there's another watershed, as has been already mentioned by Professor Datta Gupta. As we proceed, we will perhaps have an opportunity to go into this question of whether Wittgenstein has really broken away from the German tradition or not. There is a very strong group or lobby of thinkers who would like to squarely place Wittgenstein in the Kantian tradition, vis-a-vis his Kant's noumena, unknown and unknowable, Wittgenstein's tractatus, mystical focus, and many other points also. Similarly, there has also been a trend of trying to pull early Wittgenstein towards Chomsky and Chomskyan linguistics for various reasons. Today, I would like to divide my presentation into two parts, and throughout the day I will be focusing only exclusively on two texts, that's the Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, an earlier text, and the later text will be Philosophical Investigations. Though Wittgenstein has so many titles to his credit, we know that the only book that was published during his lifetime, and he was able to go through the proofs and see the publication through, was the Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. All the other publications are posthumous. At the end of the first session, we could break for about, not break, but have a discussion for about 15 minutes. And if there are any pressing questions while I proceed, that if you feel that it's just unintelligible, we must get this clarified before we go any further, then please feel free to just raise your hands. And I think I'm quite attentive. I'll be able to see it, but I may not address it just then, because sometimes I'm in the middle of a very complicated argument, and if I lose my chain of thoughts, it might create a problem for me as well as for you. I'll at times use the board, and I'll also use a write-up that I have. A very rough account of this write-up has been circulated as an abstract, and since I had a little more time to go through it, I was able to flesh it out a little. So basically it's that what has been circulated, but there are things that I have added to it. For instance, I've added a considerable amount to the first portion, the bibliographical sketch part that's there, based on several accounts. I couldn't get my hands on Malcolm, that would have been very useful. So we know that Wittgenstein was born in 1889. He's of an Austrian origin and a Jew. And his position, I think, vis-a-vis Max Mueller Bhavan would also be a bit enigmatic, because being an Austrian, Austria being taken over by Germany, he's not liking that, not taking up German citizenship, but taking up British citizenship, gives a kind of very checkered love-hate kind of relationship between the German language, the German people, country, and the state, and German philosophy vis-a-vis Oxbridge philosophy. So it's a very interesting kind of cocktail that we get in Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein was a child prodigy, you can see by the dates, because born in 1889, and in 1908 he goes to Manchester to study aeronautical engineering. He did pretty well over there. He also designed some original mechanisms relating to aircrafts. And in 1911, he visited Frege, who is one of the trio that we always club together, Frege, Wittgenstein, Russell. So this again is a kind of crossing of the English Channel. On the one side you have Frege, on the other side you have Russell, and here Wittgenstein is sort of moving between these two stalwarts and accepting them as teachers. So in 1911, Frege suggested to Wittgenstein that he should go and study philosophy under the guidance of Bertrand Russell. So it was in 1912 to 1913 that Wittgenstein attended five semesters classes by Russell. And it was during this time that he was going through a very tormented period, a kind of existential problem regarding whether he is doing something worthwhile or not, and after all, what is the meaning of life? And there is this occasion that has been often retold, that he goes in an exceptionally tormented state at night to his teacher, Russell, and he sits down quietly, not saying anything for a considerable amount of time. And suddenly he gets up and asks Russell, "Tell me, am I an idiot? And if I'm an idiot, I'll go back to engineering. And if I'm not, I'll stay with philosophy." And this really gladdens the minds of students at Jadavpur University, who are always being made to feel that they're in a derogatory position, being in the arts faculty and the engineering faculty on the other side. So they're very happy to know that Wittgenstein felt that if he's an idiot, he should go back to engineering. However, I think Russell must have convinced him that no, philosophy would be a good option for him. When we look back at the biography of a person, we often say that, no, this person has had a gap in their career. But when we look at Wittgenstein, he has done so many things, but they all seem to sort of fall in together as very normal existential choices to be taken at that particular time. Going into engineering, doing mathematics, from mathematics, wanting to know more about the foundations of mathematics, getting interested in logic, going to Frege, learning about logic, coming back to Russell, learning more about logic. War breaks out, 1914, and obviously he feels the call that he should go to the war. He should attend. He was there as a volunteer in the Australian artillery in World War I. And on returning from the war, he gave away a large fortune that he had received from his father in 1912. And this is something very remarkable about Wittgenstein. You could also make that out from the later pictures and photographs that have been projected over here, that he led a very austere life, though he came from a very rich family background. But throughout his life, he led a very austere life in terms of physical surroundings and as well as in terms of his own consumption of consumer goods. In 1919, he went to a teacher's training college, and in 1920, from 20 to 26, he taught in various village schools, and the parents complained because when at one point he was teaching astronomy, and he thought that the students should be kept back in school till the stars come out in the sky and they really have a practical acquaintance with what's going on where. And the parents are very worried because the children weren't coming home. And during that time, it seems that he had maybe what would today be called a kind of nervous breakdown. He was very depressed. And he left the job at the school. And he took up a job in a monastery as a gardener. And it was during this time, around about 1925-26, when he was going through this rough period, that he wrote to his friend Engelmann, saying that he has often contemplated committing suicide. And then he says himself that I know to kill oneself is a dirty thing to do. And so he comes out of that kind of frame of mind. In 1926, he comes back to Vienna proper, and he takes up the responsibility of architecturally designing his sister's house and executing the construction of the house. And it was that time in Vienna that we know that the logical positivistic movement had started gaining ground. So there was Feigl was there, Maurice Schlick were there, Weizmann, and there were others also who regularly used to meet, and Wittgenstein often attended those meetings. Till then, the school of logical positivism had not taken a concrete shape of being a sort of movement, logical positivistic movement. They were very interested in questions relating to logic, questions relating to mathematics, and extremely enthusiastic about Russell and Whitehead's magnum opus, Principia Mathematica. And of course, Wittgenstein, by that time, had already published his Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, which he had written the notes for which he had written during the First World War. And then there's this sort of exciting story about his carrying that manuscript around in his haversack and then being captured during the war, and how the manuscript was smuggled out and published in 1921. And the English translation was published in 1922 with an introduction by Bertrand Russell, and I'll come back to that. He had a very tense relationship with Bertrand Russell, and being myself a teacher for so many long years, I can visualize the kind of a trauma both the teacher and the student had gone through when you have a very brilliant student you're very fond of, and at the same time a very difficult student to get along with. It's a difficult proposition. So in 1929, we find that he wants to continue his research, and Wittgenstein comes to Cambridge. Before that, during 1926 onwards, when he was building the house for his sister, that was the time when he got interested in Tagore. And the group, jointly, they were reading some of Tagore in translation. And one of the plays that had specifically drawn his attention was The King of the Dark Chamber, Raja. And in his letter to Engelmann, which is circulated, I thought that would be an interesting document because it's very difficult to come across that particular book, Wittgenstein Letters to Engelmann. So that letter is there in your folder, where he says, he comments that he's not sure whether the experiences related in this play are Tagore's own authentic first-hand experience or whether they've come out of the icebox. However, he changed his opinion later, and he was more respectful, sympathetic towards Tagore. And he even bought a copy of The King of the Dark Chamber and gifted it to his sister. So in 1929, when he went back to Cambridge to take up his research over there, continue his research over there, by that time, Kenny and other commentators, they observe that he had already started shifting away from his early period in the Tractatus and his thoughts in the Tractatus. He had gradually started questioning those views, though they were not in print at that time. None of it was in print before, during his lifetime. So in 1930, Wittgenstein gave lectures in Cambridge almost every year. And in 1935, he visited the Soviet Union, and there he was, initially he went with a great amount of hope, to the extent that he had also contemplated settling down in a communist country. But the kind of communism that was being practiced at that time was not actually exactly Wittgenstein's cup of tea. And he had made a comment that a philosopher should not be a member of any community. So this freedom of thought and openness should always be a primary concern to a philosopher. Any kind of closure, commitment, or sort of allegiance to a particular party line would stand in the way of good philosophy. So he gave up that idea. After a brief stay in Norway, after coming from Soviet Union, he went to Norway where he had a hut of his own, and he kept returning to that hut off and on. He came to Cambridge in 1937, and when Austria was annexed to Germany, he became a British citizen. In 1939, he was appointed professor of philosophy at Cambridge University. And before he could take up his assignment, the war broke out, and he joined the war as a medical orderly. After the war, he joined as professor of philosophy and continued only for 2 years. That's his total teaching experience in a formal teaching post, 2 years. He resigned in 1947, and in a letter to his student, he describes the life of a philosopher as a living death. It's very interesting that many people who are trained as philosophers and who are in their later life known as philosophers have found the academic university atmosphere strangulating. They didn't like it. Just at present comes to my mind the instance of Simone de Beauvoir. She is today respected as a philosopher, but she gave up her teaching career, and she also made this kind, a similar kind of remark that is claustrophobic, and this is not what she wants to do. Jean-Paul Sartre, trained as a philosopher, had a teaching faculty position, but gave up philosophy. Same we find with Wittgenstein. He's finding philosophy, the life of a philosopher, is a living death. In 1951, Wittgenstein died of cancer at the age of 61. And just before his death, he told his friends who were near around him, "Tell everybody, I had a very good life." And I remember our teacher at Calcutta University, Shankari Prasad Banerjee, used to use this quote very often at various condolence meetings, that perhaps the person who has passed away would like to say that, "Tell them I had a very good life." So this must part the biographical sketch. Now we can go into the nitty-gritty details of his philosophy. So it is customary to demarcate Wittgenstein's philosophical works into two periods. The early period, we always had a very difficult time to translate it into Bangla. We often use the expression Arbachin. But that again seems to connote a kind of innocence and lack of sophistication. So sometimes Nobin. There's the early Wittgenstein and the later period, where he is often referred to as later Wittgenstein. The Wittgenstein of the Tractatus, early Wittgenstein, and Wittgenstein of the Philosophical Investigations, which we will for short refer to as PIE. This is generally the custom. TLP is Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, and PIE is Philosophical Investigations. So his first published philosophical work was Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, which I've already said that in 1921 it was published. And the central thesis of this book is the picture theory of meaning. The book is primarily concerned with the structure of language and its relation to the world. Wittgenstein subscribed to the linguistic turn in philosophy, and this I think I would like to say a little bit about. Many from the discipline of philosophy are acquainted with this, but this would be a convenient way of looking at the trajectory of the history of Western philosophy. This talking about a turn is actually a very mechanical way of looking at philosophy. We know that philosophy doesn't proceed in terms of twists and turns like that very clearly to say that till yesterday it was this and today it's this. But it's a convenient way of looking at the period of Enlightenment and modernism, the time of Descartes, Bacon, and onwards through Kant, to refer to them as philosophers of the epistemic turn. And when we speak of the epistemic turn or the linguistic turn, or later if we want to include the political turn, what actually is being referred to is that what is to be taken as the first philosophy, where should we start? So if we look at the epistemic turn, the primary questions are epistemic questions. What can an individual know? In the case of a linguistic turn, which we could date somewhere around about the late 19th century with the works of Frege, and then continue on beyond Wittgenstein, beyond early Wittgenstein and Russell, right on into the 1930s and onwards. I would say definitely up till the 1950s, even during the period of ordinary language philosophy. So we could speak of Wittgenstein as subscribing to the linguistic turn. During the Age of Enlightenment, philosophy took an epistemic turn, with which this shift, metaphysics was no longer considered to be the first philosophy as it was in Plato and Aristotle. Epistemology was now considered to be the first philosophy. The dictum was, the limits of my knowledge are the limits of my world. So if I cannot know a thing, that thing does not exist in my world, which was very clearly stated by Kant, that if there is anything outside that which I know through the application of my categories, then to me that is not a part of my knowledge. Whether it is there or it's not there, I'm not in a position to say. It is unknown and it is unknowable. So the limits are fixed by the limits of knowledge. The linguistic turn took place around the end of the 19th century with the works of Gottlob Frege, and it took a robust shape during the beginning of the 20th century with the publication of Principia Mathematica, 1910, authored by A.N. Whitehead and Burton Russell. Wittgenstein made a major contribution to the linguistic turn through his Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus. The dictum was now changed from the limits of my knowledge or the limits of my world to the limits of my language or the limits of my world. So what I cannot articulate in language, what cannot be represented in language, is something that I cannot even conceive of, because even my concepts are understood in terms of linguistic expression. So without a linguistic expression, I do not know what that thing can be. And Wittgenstein, in his author's preface to the TLP, remarks, "It will only be in language that the limit can be set, and what lies on the other side of the limit will simply be nonsense." Here we could take nonsense in two ways. Nonsense in one way, we say, especially in Bangla, we say it in a very derogatory way, that's nonsense. it has no value at all. But here, what it means is that it does not have any sense, it does not have any linguistic representation, and therefore it could be something that's very valuable. It could be something that is very important in our life, but it does not belong to the category of sense. In that sense, it is nonsense. So Wittgenstein would further add that the limits of my language are also the limits of my thought, not only the limits of my world, the external world, but they are also the limits of my thought. And the book that you were referring to, Jagat Bhasha o Chintan, Amita has a very good, very instructive article over there on Wittgenstein's notion of thought. Wittgenstein also tells us what can be said clearly. Now, this is something that is highly debatable, that whatever we say in ambiguous terms or in a very shabby way, often we are reprimanded, especially if it is a publisher or an editor. They will tell us that this grammar needs to be corrected, this style needs to be sharpened, and this is a very flabby way of expressing it. Can't you chisel it a little more? Be a little clearer. This is one occasion that we come across. Another occasion that often happens is that, well, just try and understand me. You know, it's something, well, I can't express it in clearer terms than this. This is as much as I can say. But, you know, you understand what I say after all. I'm sure you understand my sentiment. I'm sure you understand my emotion. I'm sure you understand my pain. Though I cannot articulate it in black and white and in such a clear manner. Wittgenstein was very cautious about this kind of alibi, that this is something that I can think of but I cannot express. Very commonly during the Vaibhavosi, the students tell us that, you know, petyasya mukhyasya, it's coming to me but it's not coming in a very articulate way. He will not stand for this. He says that if it can be said at all, then it can be said clearly, and clarity is of paramount importance to any philosopher of language. They must learn and must lay down the ground rules that are to be followed in order to arrive at clarity. That without clarity, if there's no clarity, then Wittgenstein's prescription is that we cannot make do with some kind of diluted version. Either we are absolutely clear, or we should be quiet, silent. Don't try to articulate something in a half-articulated kind of way, partly articulated, partly left for imagination or intuition or whatever. So Wittgenstein also tells us that what can be said clearly. All the philosophers who subscribe to the linguistic turn were concerned with how language, and by linguistic turn I mean the early period, Frege, Wittgenstein, Russell, early Russell, how language could deliver clarity and certainty. Not only clear, but we must also be certain that these are the conditions that need to be fulfilled to be able to examine whether this is true or whether it is false. That doesn't mean that whatever I say is true, but it means that whatever I say has a way of ascertaining whether it is true or not. And if I take the pains of following that method, then at the end of the day I'll be able to come to a conclusion that yes, I have examined it, tested it, it is true, or no, it is not true. So this demand for clarity and for certainty, these are the two things we'll have to sort of keep with us when we are reading the TLP, because this is something that he is really struggling with, how to achieve clarity and certainty in our linguistic representation of the world. So here we have the world presentation. So here there's a presentation. The world is presented to us. And in language, there is a representation of the world. Now what we are concerned about is that whether language can represent the world or not. Number one. Number two is if language can represent the world, how accurately can it represent the world? Is it a sort of shabby representation, or is it a representation that is perspicuous, clear, and certain? We are certain that yes, this is a representation of that. Or are we always in the state of doubt that we, for the time being, think that yes, it is a representation, but we may be wrong. We are not sure. And there is no way that we can ever be sure. We are perpetually in the state of doubt that, well, yes, no, maybe, perhaps, don't really know. That's where Wittgenstein has a stake. In the TLP, he is very emphatically asserting that language can represent the world, and where the presentation cannot be represented in language, if there is a situation where the presentation cannot be represented in language, then we cannot have a halfway house of a sort of halfway kind of presentation or partial presentation. So it's an all or none situation. Either it is presented or it is not presented. If it is not presented, then we have to remain silent about it. So we have to remain silent. And this silence takes a major place in early Wittgenstein's philosophy, which will gradually come to. I personally think that he is talking about silence at two levels or two domains, two areas. One area of silence is beyond language, outside language. Language does not reach there, therefore we have to remain silent about that. But even within language, everything is not articulated through words. There are things in language which are said, and there are things which are not said but they are shown. When we look at a sentence, we can see that this is a subject predicate sentence, but the sentence does not carry that label on its cuff saying that, look here, I am a subject predicate sentence. It merely says that the table is brown. That's all it says. But looking at the sentence, if I am a native speaker of the language, then I know it is shown to me that it is of this. This is the way the words have been combined in this particular sentence. I'll be coming back to this. At present, the only thing I would like to point out over here is that which is shown according to Wittgenstein cannot be said. This is something very interesting, because often we think that that which is shown can at a different point of time and a different context and under different circumstances may be said, or it may be translated into words. But he is making a hard and fast division between that which can be said that which can be shown. Therefore, I have, in my own writings, included this also in a kind of silence, because I think that this shown element is very important in language. It's not something that language can do without. But at the same time, it is something that cannot be articulated in language itself. So now we are left that which we are not clear about, we must be silent about. And that which we are clear about, it has to be so clear that it is an accurate, exact representation of the external world. So here there was a controversy regarding whether the aim of clarity and certainty could be achieved with the help of ordinary language, the language that we use in our day-to-day dealings. Can this language be chiseled and polished to serve the purpose of giving us a perspicuous representation, a clear and distinct representation of the world? Or is ordinary language over the years, through history, corrupted to such an extent beyond redemption that it has inbuilt into it some kind of shoddiness, some kind of shabbiness, or it is part of the what we would call the mood, the mejaj of the language, that it has something that is not always very clear, but it adds to its beauty. It adds to the various nuances that it has, in spite of its not being clear. So when the linguistic turn took place in philosophy, there were philosophers who very strongly felt, and especially people who were in the logical positivistic movement, they also very strongly felt, many of them strongly felt, that ordinary language has to be replaced by some kind of artificial language. And that artificial language has to be very carefully formulated so that the pitfalls and the loopholes that are there in ordinary language that cause different kinds of vagueness, different kinds of ambiguities, imprecision, they can be avoided. So there is this controversy that whether ordinary language can be polished and made a proper vehicle of clear and distinct representation, or whether ordinary language has to be left where it is for ordinary communication. And for a philosopher or for a scientist, we need to have a different kind of language, which is a constructed language, consciously constructed language, for the purpose of clear and distinct representation. This controversy, in the introduction to the Tractatus, Russell made certain comments which I think many careful readers would not accept as being accurate accounts of the Tractatus. Historically also, it is known that Wittgenstein was not very happy with Russell's introduction, to the extent that he even went up to Russell and told him that he needed Russell's introduction so that he could be introduced to the academic world, and therefore he's tolerating it. But Russell has not understood what he wants to say. Because we know that he, in traditional terms, Wittgenstein had a break in career. He was in aeronautics, then he was in the war, then he was in the school, perhaps did something equivalent to a B.Ed. or M.Ed. or something like that, then Gardner, then back to architectural engineering. So he had a very checkered career, even though his book, TLP, was very well received right from the very beginning. And as a matter of fact, in 1929, when he came back to do his research, he submitted that same book for his PhD thesis. But this introduction is, Russell's introduction is problematic. So what Russell writes in the introduction is, Mr. Wittgenstein is concerned with the conditions for a logically perfect language, not that any language is logically perfect, or that we believe ourselves capable here and now of constructing a logically perfect language, unquote. I'll read it again. Mr. Wittgenstein is concerned with the conditions for a logically perfect language. True. Now, which language is logically perfect? That's where the question comes. Not that any language is logically perfect, or that we believe ourselves capable here and now of constructing a logically perfect language. So if we are not capable here and now, that means that we are not in possession of a logically perfect language. That's something yet to come, that is to be born. This seems to be a gross misunderstanding of Wittgenstein's tractatus. No wonder Wittgenstein was dissatisfied with Russell's introduction. Wittgenstein writes in his TLP, and this is a TLP consists of seven propositions only, full stop. They're only seven propositions. And then he thought that for the ordinary reader, he needs to clarify what he has said in these seven propositions. So he goes to like 1.01, 1.02, and goes on elaborating. Then he goes to 2, and then it's 2. So and so. So this particular quote that I'm giving you is 5.5563. 5.5563, where he says, in fact, all the propositions of our everyday language, just as they stand, are in perfect logical order. All the propositions. All the propositions in our everyday language, just as they stand, are in perfect logical order. Unquote. If this be the case, then what could be the role of a philosopher in this context? Everything is in perfect logical order. Ordinary language is sufficient. Then the ordinary layman is already representing the world. So what does the philosopher have to do in terms of interpretation or giving a theory or in any kind of facilitating role? What is the philosopher supposed to do? What the philosopher is supposed to do here is that though the ordinary language is in perfect logical order, that logical order is not always apparent. There could be a difference between the appearance and reality. What appears to be the logical form of a proposition may not be its real or true logical form. So that can only be known. What is the true logical form? That can only be known through analysis. Without analyzing the proposition, one cannot know what the true logical form is. Now, how does one analyze a proposition? For that, Russell, in his own way, Wittgenstein, in his own way, gave us a method of analysis, how the analysis is supposed to be done. And we know that these philosophers, Wittgenstein, Russell, Frege, they are all often referred to as analytic philosophers, that they belong to the school of philosophical analysis. So this insight, he says that if this, like Russell, Wittgenstein believed that the apparent logical form of a sentence may not be its real logical form. The real logical form can only be arrived at through analysis. Wittgenstein says, this is in 4.002, everyday language is a part of the human organism and is no less complicated than it. It is not humanly possible to gather from it what the logic of language is. It's not possible means without analysis it is not possible. He further says, and this is 4.0031. I'm jumping from 5 to 4 to 3 to 2 to 1 because he himself has done this. When he is talking about, say for instance, sense or meaning, all his thoughts are not listed in one place. Many of them are scattered in different places. So when he's talking about thought, he gives an insight that can be drawn and brought over here to proposition two when he's talking about picturing. Or when he's talking about picturing, the things he's saying, some of the things relevantly are said in proposition six. So often, at least the method that I follow in reading, or I have been following in reading the Tractatus, is that if I'm interested to know everything that he said about sense, or everything that he said about picture, or what he has said about thought, then I go to the index and I write down all the propositions where he has referred to thought, and then go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and try to make some kind of sense of what he is saying. So in this 4.0031, he says, all philosophy is a critique of language. Naturally, after the linguistic turn, they'll all say that all philosophy is a critique of language. That means that philosophy tries to show the scope and limit of language, what language can and cannot do. It was Russell who performed, this is again part of the quote, Wittgenstein is acknowledging this, it was Russell who performed the service of showing that the apparent logical form of a proposition need not be the real one. So when he is talking about a proposition, when he is talking about a proposition representing the world, etc., etc., then he is not taking up at random any proposition in language. He is talking about the whole theory about picturing or representing the world. Here he is talking about an elementary proposition. That's all he's interested in. He's not interested in other propositions. So an elementary proposition in some other context, other philosophers will refer to the same thing as a simple proposition or as an atomic proposition, meaning that a proposition which does not have any other proposition as its part. So a proposition in which I say that I came to Max Mueller Bhavan and I met my friends, then that would be considered to be a compound. That's, and to try and find out what does that compound picture in the external world is not where we should begin. We should break that compound into its elementary parts and find out what each elementary part is picturing in the external world. Subsequently, then we will use the logical rules of putting things together and construct more and more complex expressions. But we have to start, this is the building block method, that we have to start with the elementary propositions, and the elementary propositions are the propositions that are taken as pictures of the world. So that's what he owes to Russell when he says that it was Russell who perform the service of showing that the apparent logical form of a proposition need not be the real one of the proposition. Wittgenstein was closely associated with the logical positivists of the Vienna Circle. He was, however, never a formal member of the group. The Vienna Circle developed into a self-conscious philosophical movement with a manifesto and a program, which Wittgenstein didn't subscribe to. Especially when they said that metaphysics is nonsense, in the sense that he will keep metaphysics in the zone of silence. That's where our propositions cannot picture why I'll be talking about. The member of this group admired the TLP. Wittgenstein always resisted being identified as a member committed to a fixed position. That is what makes him a philosopher. There was a major difference in Wittgenstein's position and that of the logical positivists. For the logical positivists, metaphysics was nonsense. According to Wittgenstein, metaphysics belongs to the limit of the world, not a part of it. And he explains this, the philosophical self is not the human being, not the human body, or the human soul. This is a quote from TLP. This is 5.641. He says, the philosophical self is not the human being, not the human body, or the human soul with which psychology deals, but rather the metaphysical subject, the limit of the world, not a part of it. He explains the same point in different words. Quote, where in the world is the metaphysical subject to be found? You will say that this is exactly like the case of the eye and the visual field. But really, you do not see the eye, and nothing in the visual field allows you to infer that it is seen by an eye. So when we draw a physical eye, let us say that this is the eyeball here, then this eye has a visual field that it sees, but it does not see itself. So it sees the visual field, but it does not see the itself. And there is nothing in the visual field that allows us to infer that it exists. This is Wittgenstein's position here. Vis-a-vis metaphysics also. That metaphysics for him is very important. As a matter of fact, the meaning of the world lies in that zone of silence. But whatever we are talking about, or whatever we can talk about, belongs to the contingent world of changing facts. The philosophy of logical atomism was upheld by Wittgenstein in his TLP. The phrase logical atomism was first used by Russell in his paper Analytical Realism, written in 1911. And that's exactly 1 year before Wittgenstein went to attend his classes. That's the year he went to Frege. Wittgenstein went to Frege. Atomism as a theory of matter dates back to the ancients. An atomic fact, according to Wittgenstein, is one properly expressed by a sentence in which there are no logical constants like and, or, if, then, negation. Sentence form alone cannot be relied upon. For instance, Tom is married and Tom is married does not state an atomic fact, since it really means Tom is married to someone. So after analysis, we can find out whether it is an elementary proposition or not. And this is a general fact. Hence, logical atomism is associated with the need for philosophical analysis. Now, when we are talking about representation, on both sides, that's on the side of the world and on the side of the world, there are certain notions that need to be clarified in order to understand exactly how Wittgenstein would like to make this representation possible. So, on the side of the external world, that is the extra-linguistic world, this time now I'm putting it on this side, there are objects. And these objects are combined with one another. Let us call this a combination of objects. This combination of objects, these are the facts. Now these objects, at the side of language, the objects are represented by names. Now, something very interesting is happening over here. The objects are being related with one another. We could use different metaphors. A very common metaphor would be that we have two objects. We have two objects, and we also have something as the cement of the universe, which bridges them, the two objects, and brings them together. In that case, we would have a combination of objects, and in between we would have something that relates them. There would be these relations over there, which would actually give us in the world, then we would have to account for relations and for objects. Wittgenstein is simplifying the situation. He says that an object combines with another object, his expression is like the links of a chain. So the links of the chain, they combine without having this something third in between, because if you have something third in between, then between the relation and the object, again you will need another relation, and so on. So he is trying to avoid this question, this problem, by concatenating objects like the links of a chain, without accepting that when I say the cat is on the mat, and I have a mat
and I have a cat sitting on the mat, what does this on refer to? Where Wittgenstein will say that when I represent something in language, then for the requirement of language, I might have more elements over here, the, is, on, etc., than I have an external word. So representation does not mean that I have the same number of things that I need to represent this in the external world. I don't need the same number when I come to the level of language. Now here this on is a relational term, and this on, this relational term is telling me that it's not the case that the cat is under the mat. So this under, I can just draw by drawing a mat and drawing the cat under it without giving you any sort of relational something in between. And this is a very sticky, complicated philosophical problem, that whether relations are real or not in the external world. So I'm not going into that. I'm just giving you a flavor of the kind of sophistication that Wittgenstein was expressing in his theory. So here we have the objects, and the objects are related together. And these objects, when they are related together, notice that I have not drawn objects separately beside objects here. The first time I'm giving you an account of objects is in facts. This has a hidden agenda over here. What's that? That for Wittgenstein, objects never occur outside a combination. They are always combined. They can change their combination. They can go out of this combination into this kind of combination. The same three objects can go into a different kind of combination. Or it is possible for two to be here in this, and this one to come here into another one, another combination. But objects are never outside a combination. And that is his famous saying, that objects are both independent and dependent. They are dependent on a combination, they are always combined. And they are independent because he calls the objects the substance of the world. And in that sense, they have a substantive existence, and they have a form of their own. And this object, since they are always combined, therefore, he begins the Tractatus by saying that the world is a totality of facts, not of things. If things are the substance, then the world must be a totality of things, things put together in different combinations. But things are not available separately, they're available only in a configuration. Now the configuration that is taking place in the external world is something that is shown over there, that how are they configured, that configuration is shown. And if we did not focus on the configuration, then what would happen is that the actual world and the possible world would have the same objects. But why are they different? They are different because the configuration is different. So in the actual world, the glass is here on the table. But there could be a possible world where this glass was under the table. The same things are combined in one way in the actual world, and the combination changes in the possible world. But this is where his conservatism comes in. Conservatism in relation to the postmodernist scenario that we are familiar with today. His conservatism is that whether it is the actual world or the possible world, whether it is thought or language or the world of objects, they are all governed by the same logic. It's not that the actual world has one kind of logic and the possible world has another kind of logic, thought has still a third kind of logic. They're all governed by the same kind of logic. So this kind of experiment with pluralism, or the idea that there can be a world where Jack is taller than himself, say for instance, that is not permissible in Wittgenstein's system. So the strictures that are given are
they come from the object itself. The object has a form, and this, the form of the object determines which other object it can be combined with. Say for instance, the form of color, it can go with space, but color cannot go with sound. And so my very favorite example, students are very familiar with this, is the abul-tabul, lal gane nil shur, hashi hashi gondho. So this is not going to lead to sense. Why? Because this combination is not admissible. Who restricts the combination, or what restricts the combination? It is the object itself that restricts the combination. The object has a form that tells us what kind of combination is possible. That doesn't mean that all of them are actualized. We can have blue t-shirt, red t-shirt, green t-shirt. We can have various colors, and it may be that one particular person at one time is wearing a red t-shirt, but he could have been wearing a blue t-shirt. So that's a possibility. And we understand blue t-shirt, we also understand red t-shirt, we understand green t-shirt. So we know the meaning, but knowing the meaning doesn't tell us which one is actually the color that is being worn at that time. So the truth is not known. The truth of the state of affairs, what is the fact of the matter, we can't tell by the representation. What I can tell by the representation is the sense of the representation, what it is conveying. And I can also tell that what conditions in the external world would make it true. So when I see cat on the mat, I know what kind of picture will, what kind of state of affairs, what kind of fact will make it true. But I don't know whether the cat is actually on the mat, or the mat is lying vacant, or the cat is under the mat. That would need a further kind of examination. So looking at the proposition, this is something that very important, that he is delinking the sense of a proposition from the truth and falsity of the proposition. Knowing the sense of the proposition does not legitimize my saying that yes, I know the sense, therefore it is true. An absolutely sensible thing might be something that does not hold in the external world. So here I had a few remarks about his objects and facts, which I'd like to go through. That in the TLP, Wittgenstein says, objects can only be named. Facts cannot be named. So a name will stand for an object. So a name has reference. And a combination of names, that's a proposition. A combination of names has sense. And situations can be described but not given names. Names are like points, propositions like arrows, they have sense. So the name doesn't have sense. Now generally we say that a name, often we say that a name has sense. No, Wittgenstein is using name in a very technical sense, and the problem is the whole edifice of the TLP is standing on certain I wouldn't say presuppositions, but certain commitments, which he does not illustrate. He does not give examples of. He doesn't give an example of a name. He doesn't give an example of an object. He doesn't give an example of a fact. He just tells us that these are the features, but he doesn't tell us whether a table is an object or not, or does he mean that an atom is an object, or would he say that Ram, Sham, Jadu, Madhu are names? Oh, well, if they're not names, then are general terms like cat, bat, rat, are they names? One thing is clear from his writings, that what he calls a name is not what we call a common name or what we call a proper name. That is not a name for him. The kind of symbols that he's using for names are A, B, C. These are names. And a proposition is A, R, B. R is a relation. So A is related to B in a relation, relation R, which is not very helpful when you go out into the empirical world and try to translate whatever he's saying into ordinary language or into our day-to-day activities. It remains a kind of esoteric kind of theory, where theoretically speaking, we can understand what he's talking about. He says that an object must have only one name. one object must not have more than one name, that will lead to ambiguity. Many names should not refer to one object, that will lead to ambiguity. So he is telling us about the precautions that we have to take, that one object, one name. Object does not have sense, name does not have sense, names have reference, and proposition has sense. A proposition is a combination of names. But any kind of cluster or combination will not make it into a proposition. So there, the logical form has to be followed. And the logical form is primarily being monitored or guided by the object that corresponds to the name. That object has a form, so that object tells us that this goes with color, or this goes with space, or this goes with sound. These restrictions are there. Now, having said this, he says that the two propositions need to be understood. These two propositions need to be understood. One is that objects can only be named, and the situations can be described, they cannot be given names. These two propositions need to be understood in the context of his statement. The world is a totality of facts, not of things. So even though objects make up the substance of the world, objects are what is unalterable. Their configuration is what is changing. Configuration means the relationship, as I said, that the three can be clustered around with intersections, or they may be put in a linear manner. What would be the problem if the world was a totality of things, not of facts? Since the actual world and the possible world are made of the same substance, there would be no way to distinguish between the two worlds. It is the configuration of objects that make the difference. That in the real world there's one kind of configuration, in the possible world there's another kind. Now I come to the picture theory. As I said, that the language is supposed to represent the world. So what the language is doing, the language is going to picture the world. The language as a whole is not going to picture the world as a whole. The language in its atomic units is going to picture the world in its atomic units. So an elementary proposition is going to picture an atomic fact. That's the way the picture is going to take place. So a picture presents a situation in logical space, the existence and non-existence of states of affairs. What a picture represents is its sense. So a picture is representing its sense. How do I know that the sense, this is its sense? That's shown. The representation is shown. The picture shows its sense. Only facts can express sense. A set of names cannot. In a proposition, a thought finds an expression that can be perceived by the senses. Wittgenstein holds the general concept of the proposition carries with it a quite general concept of coordination of propositions and situation. This proposition pictures this situation. So there is a coordination between this proposition and this situation. How do I know that? They never told me that the black bag is on the table. This proposition is coordinated with this physical bag on the table. Now this coordination, that there's a configuration here in the world and there's a configuration of the names representing that. Both these configurations are shown, and the isomorphism of the form out here and the form in the proposition, this isomorphism is also shown. So a big burden is given to the shown element in language. The form is shown. And the form is more generic, I should say, the structure, which is a more specific instantiation of the form. And the form is very important. Why? Because the same elements, when the form changes, then the sense will change. Godse murdered Gandhi. Gandhi murdered Godse. The same three elements, murder, Godse and Gandhi, but put in one configuration has one kind of sense, put in another configuration has a different kind of sense. What is the difference? The difference is the difference in the structure of the two sentences. they actually, you can have two ways, two juxtapositions, both abiding to a subject predicate form, but the structures will be different instantiations of the subject predicate form. Now, in a picture, here I'm telling the picture with words. He doesn't say that we necessarily need to represent it with words. We could picture something through lines also, or different kinds of symbols. But what is important here is that the picture is supposed to be definitive. It is clear and distinct, and if it corresponds to the state of affairs, then it is true QED. It's absolutely proved that this is true. And later we'll come to find that this is being questioned not only by him, by the logical positivists themselves. Many of them are moving away from their original agenda. He also, Wittgenstein also, is moving away from this agenda of exact matching between proposition and fact, between name and object. But this, at that particular point of time when philosophers were very much enamored by the science physics paradigm and its methodology, they were anxious to hit upon a methodology of representation where they could, by definition, of the way they are defining sense, the way they are defining nonsense, by definition they can eliminate all kinds of uncertainties, ambiguities, vagueness and things like that. So in the picture theory, Wittgenstein holds the general concept of the proposition carries with it a quite general concept of coordination of proposition and situation. In a proposition, a world is, so to say, put together experimentally. Experimentally means that, supposing I have not been to the first floor or the second floor of this building, but I can experimentally say that there is a room with four chairs and a table and there's a window air conditioner over there. It's a plausible picture. So experimentally I put the names together, and then to complete that, this is the part that the logical positivist did with a great amount of sophistication, is what will be the method of verification? How do I verify what I put together to find out whether it is true or not? Which would entail going to the empirical side of the theory. That how do I empirically prove that this representation, linguistic representation, fits this fact? Apart from saying that it is shown, Wittgenstein nowhere goes into the empirical nitty-gritties of sensation, perception, observation, validation, verification, this kind of thing. He avoids discussion of what we would traditionally call the kind of empiricism that Locke, Berkeley, Hume were interested in. He also avoids any discussion of psychology in this period of time when he's doing this work. So can we, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, can we logically and philosophically give a theory for mapping the world, which is of a theory which is of any practical use at all? Or is it a theory that is a very internally coherent theory, and a theory that is promising, but it does not show us or give us any evidence that it has ever been used or it can be used? So the proposition in a picture, picture writing, could be true or false. It has a sense independence of its truth or falsehood. In 2.223, he says, in order to tell whether a picture is true or false, we must compare it with reality. Who is the we? How do we compare it? Is it under a controlled situation? What about the possible shortfalls, shortcomings of the experimenter, of the environment, etc.? That has not been discussed. the elements of a proposition do not look like the elements of reality they represent. Obviously, the words over here do not look like the picture that I had drawn on the board. They don't look alike. So then how do I know that one is picturing the other? They do not look alike the elements of reality they represent, and there is not a one-one correlation between words and elements of reality. In 2.17 he says, what any picture is, whatever form, must have, what any picture of whatever form must have in common with reality in order to be able to depict it correctly or incorrectly in any way at all is logical form. That is the form of reality. Now, how do I know that my language has the form of reality? This seems to be the old Cartesian belief that God is not a deceiver, and since he has made the world and given us the faculty of using language, he must have given us the proper kind of faculty that is capable of representing the world as it is. This kind of understanding that the form of the world and the form of language, the form of categories, they match one another, is not clearly found in Kant, because there we find that whatever is coming is being organized by us, but we don't know what the real thing is, what its real form is. It may be the same, or it may not be the same. I am not in a position to say whether it is the same or not. Now we come to the topic of the said and the shown. The TLP lays great stress on the distinction between the said and the shown. Propositions show that they say what they say. Now propositions show what they say, but here he's giving a stricture. Tautologies and contradictions, they don't say anything. It's only a contingent proposition that says something about the world. So a contingent proposition technically is a proposition that may be either true or false. Looking at the proposition, I know what will make it true, but I don't know whether that is the state of affairs or not. That I have to find out. So a contingent proposition will picture. Now there are other propositions. For instance, there are tautologies. Tautologies will say that a tautology is true under all circumstances, under all conditions. So for instance, it is either raining or it is not raining. This is always true. It's either raining or it is not raining. But here what happens is that in order to picture, the insight that he is using over here is that in order to picture, you will have to carve out something that you are picturing and exclude something that you are not picturing. So there has to be a foreground and a background. But this is what I am talking about and this is not what I am talking about. In a tautology, everything is included. Whether it's, if it's raining, that's included. If it's not raining, that's also included. Then what are you talking about? So in order to talk about something, I have to carve out a portion of the world, that is the fact that I am representing. And out of the entire logical space, there has to be one space that I am talking about, and there has to be some space that I am not talking about. But what happens in the case of a tautology is that I am so ambitious that I want to talk about the entire thing. If I am talking about the entire thing, then I end up saying nothing. Similarly, in the case of a contradiction, what happens is, a contradiction is false under all circumstances. So like a tautology includes everything, a contradiction excludes everything. It says nothing, therefore it says nothing. It ends up saying nothing. So since it is false under all circumstances, then none of this possible area of the world can be included in my picture. Then what am I talking about? My proposition becomes vacuous. So it's only in the case of a contingent proposition that I am able to picture. It's only through a contingent proposition that the world can be pictured. Tautologies cannot picture, contradictions also cannot picture. So a proposition shows, tautologies and contradictions show that they say nothing. This is a quote, 4.451. The quote says, propositions show what they say, tautologies and contradictions show that they say nothing. Because they show that either they're including all or they're excluding all. And therefore they're not saying anything. Russell mistook Wittgenstein to mean what is shown at one level can be spoken at a meta level. As I was saying, that in a different time, in a different place, maybe I can translate this and talk about it. So at one level it's shown, and then at another level I talk about the proposition itself. And I say that in that proposition, these are the things that were shown. So supposing there is this bag is on the table, then I have a proposition, the bag is on the table. Then at the meta level, I have a proposition saying the proposition, the bag is on the table, is a contingent proposition. So at that level, I'm talking about the first level proposition. And the first level proposition is talking about the world outside. Is this a possibility or not? To have a meta language. Now, Wittgenstein did not entertain the possibility of a meta-language. But Russell thinks that he did. And Russell thinks that's the only way out of this predicament of the said and shown within language. How can this be absolute and ultimate? It could be at one point of time there is something shown. But there must be some way of unraveling the mystery and saying something about that shown. Going to a meta-level and saying something about that which is shown. So Russell mistook Wittgenstein to mean what is shown at one level can be spoken of at a meta level. Russell writes in his introduction, quote, these difficulties suggest to my mind some such possibility as this, that every language has, as Wittgenstein says, a structure concerning which in the language nothing can be said, but there may be another language dealing with the structure of the first language and having itself a new structure. And that to this hierarchy of languages, there may be no limit. Meta, meta, meta. So the second level speaks of the first level. Second level has something shown, not said. Third level says something about that shown and introduces another shown and goes on like that. But this was not Wittgenstein's intention. The notion of shown, displayed, manifest, these are the expressions that he has used at different times, shown, displayed, manifest, is used in two contexts. There is a shown element in language, as for example, the sense of a proposition is shown. Shown, manifest is also used to indicate the limits of language and beyond. That's the silence where language cannot proceed. this is 6.522, he says, there are indeed things that cannot be put into words. They make themselves manifest. They are what is mystical. Now I come to the mystical focus. The mystical focus is the silence that exists where language ends, beyond the limits of language. They are what is mystical. Having explained how the problem of picturing the world is solved, Wittgenstein says that the value of the TLP consists in showing how little is achieved when these problems are solved. How little is achieved? Only contingent propositions are explained. And how contingent propositions represent the world that is being explained. So if we're really looking for certainty, this is not going to give us certainty because contingent propositions are not going to give us certainty. He concludes his Tractatus with the following observation, quote, this is 6.54, my propositions serve as elucidations in the following way. Anyone who understands me eventually recognizes them as nonsensical when he has used them as steps to climb up beyond them. So I'm using language, propositions, representation, picturing, understanding the whole thing, and then using that as a ladder, stepping stone, to climb to the next zone, that's the mystical focus, to the zone of silence. When he has used them as steps to climb up beyond them, he must, so to speak, throw away the ladder after he has climbed up it. So after all that exercise, after all that passing examinations, giving viva voces, understanding the tractatus, what I understand then is that the real meaty part of the whole thing, the metaphysics, the ethics, religion, none of this can be captured through the kind of language that he's talking about, the kind of picturing that he's talking about. It all exists beyond that. What we cannot speak about, we must pass over in silence. This is the last proposition, 7. It shows how little is achieved when these problems are solved. This is what he says in the preface. In the preface to his TLP, he says that the entire book shows how little is achieved when these problems are solved, the problems of representing the world. That too has not been solved very well. All we know is how the representation is done, but we do not know whether it is true or false. That part, it seems that apart from just being able to say that it's shown that it's there. It was much later that Wittgenstein wrote to Malcolm, what is the use of studying philosophy if all that it does for you is to enable you to talk with some plausibility, about some abstruse questions of logic, etc. And if it does not improve your thinking about the important questions of everyday life, unquote. We'll stop here for questions. Difference between form and structure. Both of them are shown, and form is the possibility of structure. In that sense, it's wider, and structure is the instantiation of form. Platonic idea and instantiation? No. Platonic idea is a metaphysical concept. Here we are talking about a logical concept.
What is the actualized?
Instance.
This is how I refute.
This is not available in writing. He was impolite to him on many occasions. two major incidents of being impolite. One is that to ask somebody to write an introduction and then say that I would not have included it in my book. Right. Actually, there was communication and conversation also going on between Frege, Russell, and Wittgenstein. And a lot of the things that we find today, it seems that there were gaps in the communication. They are understanding each other's work. Were they actually criticizing? Were the criticisms internal or external criticisms? It is not very clear.
And what would Frege's reactions to his book?
TLP. It was well received by him. And he has also acknowledged his indebtedness to Frege and to Russell in writing the TLP.
আপনার নিজের ক্রিটিকটা একটু বলুন এই যে সাইকোলজি ব্যাপারটাকে একদম বাদ দিয়ে এই জিনিসগুলোকে উনি এইভাবে প্লেস করছেন এটা যে আপনার নিজের কেন এইভাবে ভাবলেন সাইকোলজি বাদ দিয়ে কি এই প্রশ্নগুলোকে আলোচনা করা যায় মিস্টিসিজম
Well, 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 I think that that was a period in the history of ideas when they were, a large group of people were very enthusiastic about the possibility of being able to bracket subjectivity and be very objective about the whole thing. Objective in the sense of being detached from the experiment and observation on the one hand, and also the belief that reality out there was rule governed very precisely, divisible into almost Aristotelian taxonomy of categories were there waiting outside. Metaphorically, they speak about cutting reality at its joints, which I think is a very gruesome metaphor. I don't like that metaphor at all. But the idea that if I have a proper map, then it is mappable. It is out there. And by proper map, I mean a map in which I have not put in my two cents of imagination, creativity, idiosyncrasy, or whatever it is. If I put my understanding into it, then the whole thing will be one-sided and the whole picture will be jeopardized. So the best thing is to keep myself outside of that. Now, how do I do it? That could be something that I've kept as an ultimate ideal, something that has to be approximated. Not that I've been able to do it just now, but ultimately that is where I will go, number one. Number two is if I fail at any point, then it is for the peer group, it is for all of you to point out to me that this is a subjective element. Eliminate that, okay, now proceed. So the idea that the rules of the game allow you to mark this as a fault line. It's not that I'm faultless, but I know what the fault could be, and I know where to look for the fault, and I know how to repair it. So this idea, I think, is still with us very much, especially in many of the social sciences. And there's always this tendency of trying to translate quality into quantity and quantify the whole thing. So the place for quality in our understanding of the world, or the place for the subjective, as you said, in a narrower sense, in our understanding of the world, is absent, absolutely absent in this early period, and in the period, I would say, right up to the Second World War. It was the bashing of the Second World War that really sort of shook us, that everything, nothing is really permanent, everything is continuing, things will change. But in spite of that, it seems that even after that bashing, it seems that people tried to polarize and get back to a semblance of sanity in the name of, again, regimentation theory, theory building, grand theory. So no matter how much we talk about the dangers of closure, dangers of centrism, dangers of foundationalism, they are very much in vogue and very much sort of taken to be the elitist approach. Those who don't abide by that, they are not really doing hard core anything, theory or philosophy or methodology. Whatever they're doing is something soft. So, personally, I belong to that soft group. So, and always fighting for just a foothold, not for recognition, just for a foothold.
I have a question about Heisenberg, the principle of uncertainty, she had 27, 28,
27.
So, it has become a unique, you have a react to the situation. She needs to be.
ডেফিনেটলি হাইসেনবার্গের সঙ্গে চিঠিপত্র আমি জানি না, কিন্তু এটা আমি জানি যে 29 থেকে হি ইজ গোয়িং টু স্টার্ট চেঞ্জিং, এন্ড দ্যাটস হোয়াট আই এম গোয়িং টু কাম টু ইন দ্য সেকেন্ড পার্ট। আই কাম টু আ ট্রানজিশন পিরিয়ড বিটুইন দ্য টিএলপি অ্যান্ড দ্য পিআই, সেকেন্ড পিরিয়ড ইন উইটগেনস্টাইনস ইন্টেলেকচুয়াল জার্নি, অ্যান্ড দেন দ্য থার্ড পিরিয়ড উইল বি দ্য পিআই when he is really breaking away.
Heisenberg's principle of uncertainty did play a role in this changeover.
Not in the literature that we find.
What would be the epistemic status of some phenomena that can be expressed in language but are abstract? Like, for example, some mathematical phenomena or certain emotions or certain like mythical figures. So how do you, I mean, you can express it, but you can't quite say it actually exists.
Right. So in his early period and in his later period, in his early period as well as in his later period, he keeps on cautioning us about the limits of philosophy, what philosophy can do and what philosophy cannot do. And the strictures that he is placing over here at this particular period are much stricter than the kind of strictures he is going to place in his later philosophy. But in both cases, he is definitely telling us that these are the things that can be said, and of course said clearly. And emotions are very important, and we can see that also from his reactions in, when I was giving the biographical note, that his reactions to communism, his the very fact that he's willing to become a gardener, the fact that he's giving up his parental inheritance and things like that. So there must have been a very strong sentiment, feeling, emotion element in his day-to-day living. But how can that become an important feature in theory, in philosophy, becomes a big question. And that's why he says that the whole exercise is actually leading you to the futility of this, because what he is able to talk about is the domain of science and the language that science is using. And that at the end of the day is not going to satisfy the kind of quote-unquote quest that we have in life. So, but in his later philosophy he comes back to this question. That all of these things have to be addressed, except he does not address, and that in the last part I'd like to bring up, he does not address the presence and importance of politics and power. He doesn't address that. He breaks away a lot of, goes a far distance away from this kind of foundationalist position, but there is a limitation to how far he's going. Though many things can be extrapolated for the purpose of the kind of things we are interested in today. But he himself was not interested in it.
When Dr. Mani
bolchen
je world and language,
it's
not
that
we are language bolte pari, describe korte pari, sheigulo amar domain er modhe. Baki gulo silence. মানে তার মানে আমি যেগুলো নিয়ে ভাবতে পারি দ্যাট রিকোয়ার্স ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ। তার মানে কি উনি এটা বলতে চাইছেন যে টু থিঙ্ক ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ ইজ ইট রিকোয়েস্টেড
থটের জন্য, এইটাই তো আমি তার বিষয়, এটাই যে থটের জন্যও ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ এবং উইথ দ্য সেম লজিক অলসো দ্যাট কানেক্টস টু দ্য কোয়েশ্চেন দেয় দ্যাট ইমোশন ইজ ইমোশন থট অর নট, ইজ সেন্টিমেন্ট থট অর নট। By thought he is talking about a very regimented kind of thought which is guided by the laws of thought.
Right, any thought requires language.
It's the limit. Silence is the limit, so it's on the other side. So if something is outside language, you cannot bring it into language.
And I mean, the age of the generation, that actually, to, we, on a generation, we say, অনেক সময় বলি যে থটের জন্য ল্যাঙ্গুয়েজ ইজ নট রিকোয়ার্ড, পার্টিকুলারলি লোয়ার অ্যানিমালসের ক্ষেত্রে তারা কি ভাবতে পারে না, এরকম তো আমরা বলি, সেটার জন্য জিনিস করছি।
That's one question right at the back, and that will be the last question, I think. That will be the last question. Yeah.
How do you distinguish between elementary proposition and tautologies?
Oh, no, no. Elementary proposition, I would not distinguish between the two. I'd say that an elementary, let's say it this way.
Elementary propositions are all contingent.
Contingent, huh?
Well,
tautology hobby na, মানে elementary proposition hobby na. The distinction টা কিভাবে জানতে চাইছি? That's not what I'm. A tautology is true under all circumstances, and there is this either or, either P or not P, and a contradiction will say P and not P, contradiction.